It's the light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Welcome, Talk Catholic, the website.com. Your host, Tim Kilcoyne. No agendas here, just the straight and narrow. Through Mary to Jesus, the Catholic faith proclaimed and preserved. Hope to see you here every week.
TalkCatholic.com with Tim Kilcoyne. It is First Saturday. And please don't forget your First Saturday commitment to go to confession, go to Mass, say the rosary, meditate on a particular mystery for 15 minutes, and offer some kind of random act of kindness to your neighbor. And in such praise of Our Lady and His Holy Spirit, I'd like to air again a particular interview with our friend, Brother Alphonsus Maria, slave of the Immaculate Heart of Mary, on the message of Our Lady of Akita, which parallels the message of Fatima. And I think it's ever apropos in light of our recent shows on the diabolical disorientation. So may we reintroduce Brother Alphonsus Maria.
In 1973, Our Lady appeared, gave a message to this sister, Agnes, in Akita, Japan. It was basically, from what I understand, to corroborate the message of Our Lady of Fatima in 1917, but since that was not being followed or paid attention to much, she was repeating pretty much the same message of penance, say the rosary, make sacrifices for sinners, and I guess the statue there of Our Lady of Akita started weeping. They recorded it eventually 110 times or 11 times.
Wow.
And even the bishop there did see it himself, Bishop Ito.
Yep. Wasn't there a cross in the statue?
I'm not sure. I don't know the whole story that well, really.
Okay.
But now, so that's in 1973, but now most recently on October 6th, 2019, voice came to her again with it's the WQPH radio 89.3, which you're listening to. The founder of that is Marianne Frasoli Harold, and she's the one that received this courier from Japan. Now, she is very much involved in holy things for years, and so I'm sure she has special content, but they made a point of seeing her, getting this message to her, knowing that she had the radio station, to make it the message known. That was to make the message known. And so she, as she says here now, WQPH is a small 8-year-old prayer-based apostolate serving the North Worcester County of Massachusetts as an affiliate of EWTN Radio. We do not enjoy the financial security of better-known stations, and like all Catholic organizations, we have felt the reduction of charitable giving caused by demoralizing scandals and confusion of the present, which seem to be without end. In short, we have no reason to take on the risks associated with publishing a sensational story such as this new message from Sister Agnes Sasagawa, other than on behalf of sources who are both reliable and courageous and who have asked us directly to spread her message. To the many individuals who have contacted us, we have received your concerns with humility, and we recognize that an update is important to our credibility. But we prioritize foremost the safety of our sources. So we appeal again to you for your prayers, to pray for all the messengers of the truth today in the Church, in particular for Sister Agnes and her confidants. The new message asks each of us to pray a penitential rosary daily, and to cover ourselves in ashes, as the residents of Nineveh did upon hearing the prophecy of Jonah. And so that's a wonderful callback now to the Old Testament. God wanted Jonah to preach to Nineveh. In 40 days, Nineveh will be destroyed. And Jonah said, oh, you're going to forgive them anyway. I'm going away. And he got on the ship. And then there was this going to sink, and finally they said, who's causing this big storm? And the lot fell on Jonah. He said, okay, I'm disobeying God. Throw me overboard. So So then the whale eat him up, you know, swallow him, and brought him back to land. And so he said, okay, God, I'm going to go back. So it's a three-day journey across Nineveh. It
okay. took
3 days to get across Nineveh at that time. And so he started preaching, in 40 days, Nineveh will be destroyed. And after the first day, the king heard it and took that long. And he said, oh, that we should all go into sackcloth and ashes.
Okay.
And also all the animals go into sackcloth and ashes. And so God said, okay, I see you repent and regret what you've been doing, the sins, and stop them. I will not punish you.
Very good.
So that's the message that's tied, this is being tied into. So...
Now, I'm curious, is she putting forth that call to all Catholic Christians or the select group of those who can? In other words, God so often is willing to save the populace because of the reparation and atonement of the few.
Yes, I don't know the detail here. It says, the other day I just sent you a correction email regarding Sister Agnes Sasagawa. Let me write something important else. On October 6th, so that's a crucial date now, October 6th, 2019. Is that what it was?
The time of the Amazonian Synod.
That's the day that officially the Amazonian yeah. Synod officially began.
Interesting.
And it lasted till October 26th. So horrible things have happened because of that, in that thing, as far as trying to change the church.
Mm.
It's unbelievable what has been brought up in that synod.
And I can't remember exactly the apparition, but there was referencing of a bad synod by Dr. Taylor Marshall on one of his shows.
Yes, and so. I know, I heard you tell me that before, but I hadn't heard that. But on top of that, October 4th, the 2 days before that, is when all the Amazonian people were there in the Vatican Garden in front of the Pope, and they brought two pagan statues, idols, naked women, actually, and they said, well, maybe it's Mary and Elizabeth, and Vatican was trying to explain all kinds of things. They didn't seem to know what was going on. But it turns out that it was a Pachamama is the name. It means a Mother Earth, and it's a pagan statue, the two of them. So they were put in at one point in time in another church in Rome, Susperna or something. I think the name of the church, a few days about the beginning, October 10th maybe or so. I don't have the dates exact though. But there's a wonderful young man from Austria heard about what was happening, about these pagan statues being in the Catholic Church.
Yes.
And he came down and had a friend take a picture of him, a movie. And so they went into this church that had the two pagan statues there in a very prominent place. And he took them out. It was early in the morning. The church had just opened. And so he threw them into the Tiber River.
Yes.
Now, that did make worldwide news. And then, about 5 days later, he came publicly and said, I am the person who did that. I did not want the message to be confused. The message is there should be no pagan idols in a Catholic church, period.
Exactly.
And so I myself, my grandfather was Catholic and became Lutheran. And when I was 15, I became Catholic. And I studied my faith well, and my first name is Alexander, and I forget his last name, but he's from Austria. He's been married 1 year. He's 26 years old. And he said, I checked with a priest if that would be all right to do, and I got permission to do it. And so he said, and the Pope then, when they got the commandery or whatever, the police, suddenly got, they did restore the statues. The Pope said it was wonderful to get them back, and he put them back in another church. He was going to make them even publicly in St. Peter's, some solemn ceremony, and some of the cardinals objected finally.
Yes.
So there was we found there was a problem. But this wonderful young man, he started an organization called St. Boniface, an organization of some kind. I haven't checked it out myself, but St. Boniface in Germany, he cut down this tree, which was an idol to the German people.
Yep.
And so that's why this wonderful boy, Alexander, is taking on, you know.
Yes. And all of this episode that you're referring to, he called upon four exorcists, I believe. to come forward. And on a particular day of fasting and prayer, they were all of the belief that a demon of some sort was left on Vatican ground, consequence to all that happened.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah. Dr. Wow. Taylor Marshall also referred to that.
Yeah, you might mention that the sources.
He did a whole show on that, I believe. Okay.
So another wonderful person to be listening to on YouTube or whatever, Dr. Taylor Marshall.
Or Dr. Timothy Gordon.
Or Dr. Timothy Gordon. They are fantastic, strong defenders of the Catholic faith.
Absolutely.
Then also there's LifeSite News.
Yeah.
There's John Henry Weston, I believe.
That's right.
But all the news, Catholic, they're straight. We're telling the straight story.
Now, dovetailing all of this with the revelation, private revelation, which it is, given to Sister Sasagawa.
Yeah.
Go ahead and give us a little more.
The third message of Our Lady of Akita. Now, why is third? I don't know. Okay. My dear daughter, listen well to what I have to say to you. You will inform your superior. As I told you, if men do not repent and better themselves, the Father will inflict a terrible punishment on all humanity. It will be a punishment greater than the deluge, such as one will never have seen before. Fire will fall from the sky and will wipe out a great part of humanity, the good as well as the bad, sparing neither priests nor faithful. The survivors will find themselves so desolate that they will envy the dead.
Wow.
The only arms which will remain for you will be the rosary and the sign left by my son, which I presume is the crucifix, the cross.
Mm.
Or
remember Garibandal, where there was a chastisement predicted and a sign left permanently on earth.
Yes, no, that hasn't happened yet. There are four stages of that Garibandal of 1960.
Yeah.
Yes, we still have that waiting. Each day recite the prayer of the rosary, and with the rosary pray for the pope, bishops, and the priests. The work of the devil will infiltrate even into the church in such a way that one will see cardinals opposing cardinals and bishops against other bishops. The priests who venerate me will be scorned and opposed by their confreres, churches and altars sacked. The church will be full of those who accept compromises, and the demon will press many priests and consecrated souls to leave the service of the Lord. The demon will be especially implacable against souls consecrated to God. The thought of the loss of so many souls is the cause of my sadness. If sins increase in number and gravity, there will be no longer pardon for them. With courage, speak to your superior. He will know how to encourage each one of you to pray and to accomplish works of reparation. It is Bishop Ito who directs your community. You have still something to ask? Today is the last time that I will speak to you in living voice. From now on, you will obey the one sent to you and your superior. I alone am able still to save you from the calamities which approach.
So there's still hope.
Yeah, there's still hope.
On the part of our reparation effort.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah.
And it gives us a little bit more detail about the nature of the destruction, because it's hard not to connect the dots with the Fatima Third Secret, where there was something left out. There was the vision of a pope in white, and he's fleeing a city where there's bodies all over the place, and then there was no explanation. Usually in every apparition of Our Lady, whatever is revealed will then be explained. Mm-hmm. And in this particular case, it was kind of left out there hanging and was never clearly enunciated for God's people, going back to 1960 when it was supposed to all be revealed.
Mm-hmm.
So in this case, we got really a new revelation that it's going to be fire from heaven.
Mm-hmm.
And good and bad. She refers, I believe, to bad priests and good priests, good people and bad people. It isn't going to make any difference.
Yeah.
We're all going to suffer from this, and that the living will envy the dead.
Yeah.
Unbelievable. Which, now, it certainly begs the question that is this truly the revelation of the Third Secret, that this is an offshoot or a sequel to that which was already more or less revealed to us.
Hold that thought. This is WQPH Radio, 89.3 FM.
You know, at one point in time, two of our community went to Fatima to Father Joachim Alonso, a convert from Judaism, who was the official historian of the Fatima. He wrote 24 volumes, I believe, or 26, about the history of Fatima. And now the Rome only allows two of them to be even mentioned. Oh. And the two members of the community that went there got permission from him to take a section about the secret of Fatima that he had written and brought it back, and they had it translated. I was responsible for, I proofread it twice before I saw what the real secret is, because it was, should it be this blowing up here? No, no. So he just brought up all kinds of questions and discounted them. And finally he said, when Our Lady said, the dogma of the faith will always be kept in Portugal, .. That's where the third secret is and was not being revealed. And so the Cardinal Odi was finally quoted as saying, and he's one that has read it, he said, it's a loss of faith in the whole church, and it begins at the top.
Yes. Yeah, I've heard
so that. That's a horrific thing. No wonder no one wants to say that.
Exactly. Yeah, and that in this message of Akita, there is a direct referencing of bishop against bishop, cardinal against cardinal.
Right.
There's real tension and dissension within the church herself.
Yeah. And also all the Masons that have been involved. You know, I was in Rome in 1989 when one of our brothers was ordained by Pope John Paul II. Several of us were taken through the seminary building where St. Maximilian Kolbe had studied as a seminarian. And this priest, who was a member of that order, told me that he said, when Maximilian Kolbe was here, the Masons gathered outside in St. Peter's Square and just raised their fists against the Pope and the Church, said, we will destroy you. And so that's why St. Maximilian Kolbe then decided to start the MI, the Militia Immaculata, we called it, the Militia of the Immaculate, and he used the miraculous medal as this weapon. And Mary says, O Mary, conceived without sin, pray for us who have recourse to thee. And St. Maximilian Kolbe added, and pray for those who do not have recourse to you, especially the Masons.
Oh, wow.
So he added that.
Interesting.
So that so many Catholics in the world belong to that MI of St. Maximilian Kolbe. And see what a firebrand he was in all his life. When he was young, he was sort of a wild guy. And his mother said, I don't know what I'm going to do with you. And so he took that seriously. He went to a statue of Our Lady and he said, Mary, what's going to happen to me? And she said to him, I give you a choice for a white crown or a red crown.
Yeah.
He said, I'll take both.
I was at a particular church just this past Sunday.
Really?
And I took a picture of this magnificent picture of St. Maximilian Kolbe with Our Lady presenting him the two crowns.
Oh, really?
Yeah, very beautiful.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Yeah, talk about
so
that.
So he did it.
Coincidental.
The white, red for the martyrdom. And they were greater love than this, and no man has than to lay down his life for his friends.
Exactly.
And he offered to do that, as Jesus did. And that's...
And those two crowns, therefore, represent really the choice for all consecrated religious, especially bishops.
Yes, right. Yeah.
That they're going to receive suffering, and it's just a matter of whether it might take their own life or be a form of persecution, of ridicule, scorn, derision, etc.
Right, exactly. Yeah. And that's why their cardinal's robes are red. You know, for blood.
Yes.
Now, lots of times they speak about the royal purple. And that's really red. The royal purple is red. And some bishops, you see that the comments with others, they're all purpley. But it's the real blood red.
Yes. It's, you know, it's hard not to connect the dots with why the 1973 message, when you think of what 1973 really represented in the aftermath of Vatican II. You had, for us in America, it was the unfortunate year of Roe v. Wade.
Oh,
okay.
Yes, absolutely.
And then you also have the absence of the prayer of St. Michael from the Mass. At the beginning of the Mass, I believe that was 1973, that was ditched.
It was at the end of the mass, he was just
saying. Yeah, end of the mass, okay. Yeah, yeah. And then, what else, 1973... Oh my goodness!
That's crucial.
Yeah, there was some. Oh, there was the oath that we were talking about.
The oath against modernism.
Exactly, that was thrown out the window. 1973.
Is that right?
Yes, and then of course you have the mass exodus of priests who had left the priesthood because they did not accept so many of the changes of Vatican II.
Yeah.
But I mean, that if there was ever a turbulent period, let's say 65 to 75, the documentation statistically on the negative exodus of Catholics from church attendance is just a complete downward spiral. There has to be a connection as to why it was important to call to memory the Fatima message.
Yes, and then also now this October 6th message from Akita ties in with what the Pope has been doing with the Amazonian Synod.
His personal opinions are being presented as magisterial.
Yeah, unbelievable.
Yeah, and we, in another show, we did call to mind some of these statements relative to the Sixth Commandment, you know, approving of basically adultery of those married without getting an annulment and they can receive.
Yes.
Plurality, God wills a plurality of religions.
Yeah.
A diversity of religions.
Yeah.
You know, there's just recently this past week, there was referencing of a kind of a diminishing of the co-redemptrix role of Our Lady.
Yeah.
And I remember Sister Agnes talking about how stern Our Lady was in revealing that message. Her, you know, she talked about the Father is not pleased. Mm. All right. And things must change or there will be destruction. There was a real dead seriousness conveyed in that message, perhaps a little different than, you know, what might have been given to the children at Fatima.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, more important for us Catholics today who are clearly on the edge of our seat, those who are truly faith-filled and prayerful and worried, to be bluntly honest, it is a legitimate time to worry when you see the manifestation of division. As somebody like myself, and I'm no doubt yourself, you know, we've seen this division bubbling forth over many decades, and now it just seems to be kind of, you know, completely exploding.
Mm-hmm.
In that light or darkness, we have to pray for all our leaders, all the bishops and cardinals, and most especially the Holy Father, you know, that they accept their conversion from cradle to grave with everyone else. You know, we're all in motion, either backwards or forwards, and we can slip and slide at any chapter in our life. And at this point, we really just need to pray for the Holy Father to be completely on board with the deposit of faith, which is unchanging, to be passed on from one generation to the next, not to be questioned to the point of disappearing.
Absolutely.
And then, of course, that's what could happen if there's a movement towards this Abrahamic center, which will become kind of a center point of a new world order ideology where all religions blend in with one another and we'll all engage in so-called interreligious dialogue. But in fact, we know how that went for us in terms of the ecumenical movement. Nobody knew their Catholic faith to begin with. Kind of hard to, you know, enter into dialogue when you don't know who you are.
Brother, the moment has arrived. What do we need to do?
Study your faith. Learn, know your faith well.
Yeah.
Research it. Know what just the Catholic faith is.
Yeah.
And then if you see it being challenged, then act on it.
Yes.
Go and do something to protest that there was a bad teaching. Doing with prudence, of course.
Yes.
But we've got to speak up.
That's it.
So
there is a certain militancy that may be called upon at this current time.
Yes, we are the church militant. Amen.
Down
Amen.
Here, no doubt. Only church triumphant in heaven, right? So we have to get there first. Yeah. Creating something holy for our Lord always brings great peace to me.
That's beautiful. And I remember a quote from St. Jerome, who translated the Bible into the Latin. He said, "To ignore the scriptures is to ignore Christ."
Yes. Yeah, yeah.
So we've got to know the scriptures well.
Yeah, we got to start reading.
Megalunai he psuke mu ton korion.
Exactly. And someday I'll know what you said.
That's the Magnifica. That's my favorite phrase.
I got to buckle down and take a course in Latin. That's maybe.
No, do like Greek.
Okay. All right. Very good. All right. Well,
Greek
then.
Greek is wonderful.
Well, let's go to that class together, ladies and gentlemen. This is WQPH Radio 89.3 FM. See you next week.
Let your light shine. That is what it's all about here at WQPH Radio 89.3 FM. But we need to hear your story. You want your voice to be his voice. That is making the faith known to others. Please, my number is 877-625-3727. Tim Kilcoyne, TalkCatholic.com. St. Mother Teresa told us, your ministry is your work right where you are. Grab on to this microphone. God bless.